Good evening and welcome to the broadcast of the Enid City Commission meeting. Broadcasting live in high definition from the council chambers at the City Administration Building located at 401 West Owen K. Garriott. Please stay tuned as Mayor Bill Shuey presides over the meeting.
David Zuick did it.
Okay.
I had this 5 years ago.
Yeah,
I said,
well,
glad you could
stop
again.
By. A touch up.
But
yeah.
My eyelash are going into my eyeballs.
I
thought
it
feels like
sounds,
there's a lot of gum in there.
Yeah. No fun.
Let's get started. We'll call the meeting to order. Linda, we're all present except for Tammy. I have not heard from Tammy. Item two, discuss and take necessary action on the fiscal year 2016-2017 City of Enid budget. We'll now adjourn to convene as the Enid Municipal Authority. All of the trustees of the Enid Municipal Authority are in attendance at the special meeting except for Tammy Wilson.
Mayor, we need to go back to city and we need to talk about a couple of departments there before we move on to EMA.
Need to go back where? I went right by that. Thank you. Keeping you on your toes, Aaron. Item two, discuss and take necessary action on the fiscal year 2016-2017 City of Enid budget. Sorry.
You're great. Tonight we're gonna start off with VDA, and then when we finish that up, we're going to move into the police and fire funds, and the chiefs are here to present their funds tonight. Then we're gonna move on to EMA after that, and then we'll finish up with the EDA, and Brent Kessling is here to address the ERDA this evening. So, and those are just the highlighted funds that I just went through. VDA, there's not a lot of change, hardly any. $300 decrease overall is what in utilities, and that's based on some billboard utilities are coming in a little lower. Increase in organizational dues and conference and training, and that's related to Mike Cooper's contract. Other than that, everything remained the same from previous year budgets there.
What page is VDA on?
It's on page 134.
186 in our book.
What did you say, Dave?
It's in 186.
Of the PDF?
This? VDA?
Okay.
I don't know, 134.
I'm sorry.
186.
All right, that's 186. That's
I have 186.
Yes, that's correct. 186.
You have a question, Ron?
Yes, I do. You mentioned the signs. What's the expenditure on the signs that's on here?
There are two billboards that we currently pay utilities for to light those signs, and there's one out by Gray Ridge on 81, and then there's one out on 412 by 42nd Street.
Are they going to change the covers on those signs this year?
We currently
can't afford it.
Currently don't have it in the budget, but we are going to change the sign out at the Gott Road. That's what we have planned right now for the current fiscal year. Those signs take about, I think it's about $3,000. We're getting quotes on the one at the gate. And so if we can come up with some money, we could change some of them. Our plan is not to change them all at one time, which would be takes a significant amount of funds, because then you'd have to replace them all at the same time. I think currently they have stuff up about Enid talks about blue skies and boldness and stuff like that.
There are four that need to talk about Vance Air Force Base. And they got off track about 4 years ago.
Yeah.
They were promoting the city of Enid and not Vance Air Force Base as they were supposed to.
I brought up the electricity. Are those signs actually lit now?
Some of them are. I don't know if all of them.
Somebody told me, though, the one coming in the south is not lit.
There is a bill that we're getting, and there is wattage usage on that bill, so.
It's pretty easy to check out.
Maybe we ought to send somebody out there and check and see if we're, if it's lit, because I mean, you know, the two of them, the entrance signs are supposed to be lighted.
Cooper, he gets passed.
And they're connected.
We will do that. We will do that.
Good point.
Yeah.
PDA billboards.
But if, like I say, if we don't put money in the budget this year, I think that we should definitely put money in the budget for the next fiscal year to change the signs over to the what they were supposed to be promoting.
That is in the mill, Ron.
Yeah. That's
should
all.
We further this discussion on entryway signs, Ron?
I don't care if you want to.
Not tonight.
Not as the BDA.
You may, Aaron.
I'm expecting that'll be talked about tomorrow in the capital improvement stuff.
Yeah. Oh, good. Okay. Get ready.
Well, we have a huge asset out there.
Are there any other questions on VDA before we move on to police funds next?
While we are on the VDA, I had a conversation with Gerald about something here just a week or so ago that I was curious about. I noticed that on our claims list that we're paying for Mike Cooper's cell phone.
That's correct. That's under the utilities line in this budget.
And is that something that we're obligated contractually to do? The reason I ask that is, you know, everybody now has got a cell phone that they use for whatever purpose, that they need a cell phone. And
I think that
I just hard for me to understand why, you know, I understand why we pay for his travel. To me, he'd have a cell phone that he, whether we paid for one or not, unless he has a separate cell phone that that we're providing for him. Just
it is in his contract.
Yes, it is.
So that's why we do it. It's been in his contract since we've had him, which has been probably 10 years or so.
8 years, 9 years.
Well, once upon a time, cell phones were kind of a specialized thing that not everybody had, but now everybody's got one, and it just seems like to me that we're spending money on something we really don't need to.
Well, we probably can't do anything about it until his contract's up for renewal.
Well, how often is that?
4 more years.
Contracted for how many years? We just renewed it?
I don't think it's that long, is it?
We renewed it 1 year ago, maybe 2 years ago.
I thought it was a 3-year contract for some reason. Anyway, I mean, if it's in the contract, there's not a lot we can do.
We have employees of the city of Enid that we provide cell phone service for.
We will look up, I'm taking a note now, we will look up and get Cooper's contract out to you guys sometime between now and tomorrow so that you can, I can't recall right now how long it's for, but it's for a period of time.
Could be 3, but I've got 5. Anyone else?
What's the scholarship program?
Can I explain the scholarship program?
The Advanced Development Authority set up a scholarship program to help cover costs that are not already covered for airmen and spouses and dependents of airmen. There's only certain criteria where they qualify. If they're already being paid by somebody else, they can't come over here and get that duplicated or anything of that nature. But a lot of what is utilized on that program is textbook reimbursements that aren't covered under programs that are offered by the Air Force.
Is it used?
It is used. It's been used significantly more in the past than it is currently because a lot more stuff has been picked up and covered by the government over time.
We used to allocate $40,000, and I think it's been reduced to $30,000.
Right.
That because it hasn't been used as much.
That is true.
So I was wondering, do we need to keep it there or do we lower it?
I think that, Mr. Mayor, you could probably speak to it as chairman of the VDA. I know from the Advanced Development Authority, folks, they think it's a good benefit. As Aaron just said, the federal government pretty much picks up most of the, or all of the tuition for pilots and Air Force members. So this primarily, I think, is helping to pay for books and for spouses, I think.
That is correct.
Course credit.
And it's a good item on what we provide for spouses at Vance Air Force Base. I would hate to see us remove it.
I would think that would be something we want to discuss with the board, and I do believe they have a meeting tomorrow, if I understand correctly. So
10 o'clock in the morning.
Anything else on VDA? right, I'm going to turn it over to Chief Burke and let him walk through each of his funds.
Mayor and Commissioners, I'm lucky enough to have four different funds. I guess we'll start with Fund 12. I don't know what page that is. It's called Special Projects.
Page 86.
Oh, there it is.
Brian, before you start, has anything been changed other than what's in the...
No, the budget that we have given you, what we've done is taken notes, comments that were made about things that you would like to see in there. And so we're capturing those, and we intend to roll those up and bring those back to you before approval for you to look at and see if you want to add them. We're anticipating that you want to add them. And certainly if you make it clear by taking action tonight, we'll know to add something or delete it. We have taken notes on all the items that were mentioned at the last meeting. But nothing's been changed in the book currently.
Okay.
Chief.
Okay, special projects, and I'll be brief. Questions are probably worth more than anything. this is a fund that we have that is separated into funds 1, 2, and 3, special projects 1, 2, and 3. 1 is restitution, miscellaneous funds go in there. 2 is state seizure money. 3 is federal seizure money. And usually we budget this at a fairly low revenue rate, but usually at a higher expense rate, because a lot of times, say if we bought a narcotics vehicle, we would ask for money out of the DA's revolving fund. It'll get placed in as revenue into Special Projects 2 and then paid out of Special Projects 2. So we never really know what seizures are gonna bring in the way of revenue. We're still expecting well over 100,000 for Special Projects 3 this year from Homeland Security, but they put us freeze on equitable sharing, but that freeze has been released. So I asked them the other day, I said, where's my money? So we should be getting some from the government. But these funds are just basically used to fund the narcotics operation.
And this is all somebody else's money?
Yes, it's all restitution, things that are ordered to the courts, and seized funds. So we never really know what we're gonna get. So we just manage them, and this fund has been around probably almost 20 years, and it's pretty self-sufficient. Any questions on special projects? More challenging ones. Next one will be Fund 50, 911. It's on page 122. This one's more of a challenge. This year, we're looking at about a $213,000 deficit. Obviously, everybody knows that 911 funding, it's being funded by landlines, wireless, and VoIP, and a lot of that's going down. Landlines are disappearing for wireless phones and internet phones. What we're looking at is really digging into the fund balance, and I'm hoping we'll get through this year. I'm gonna make some changes. We're in very, very preliminary talks with Alfalfa County to try to get them on board, possibly even Blaine County, because that's the current trend, is to group counties together. It's a great deal for us. We got Major County, our revenue from them is about $160,000 and probably get about 6 to 9 911 calls a month. So the workload's really not that bad for the revenue, that's for sure. So this year, what I've told them is we're gonna run 2 people short and try to get by, try to not make this deficit. I wanna shrink this deficit a whole lot, balance at the end of this year that's greater than what it shipped. So we should be able to get by with that. Would, you know, reserve the right to fill it up if the revenues come in. Now in November, what I'm hoping for is the state legislature gets that House bill passed that will increase wireless and VoIP. I'm not gonna increase it very much, increase it a quarter, but I'll take it, which that should help our revenues and we should be a lot more self-sufficient. So.
Are you hearing anything about that?
Excuse me?
Are you hearing anything?
I'm hearing good things, that it's still moving, it's still breathing.
It's not dead yet.
And I think it'll go.
It's not dead yet.
That's true.
I think it'll go. I mean, every 911 center across the states having issues because of
the. Plug that, those numbers in?
Did we put them in?
Yes.
Probably. A little, we tweaked it a little optimistically. A
little asterisk?
A little optimistically. I think we don't know how much that would bring in.
It's a good problem to have.
So, yeah. So we'll get by and without cutting any service or, and hopefully adding service this year.
Brian, when we took Major County over, it took so long because they still had to do all the addresses with alfalfa already be set up, or if that would come about, it'd be installed a lot quicker.
To my knowledge, alfalfa is already in with Woods County, but I don't think they're getting along.
Yeah, I'm on that board and I know that, but I thought it took Major County so long to get it all installed, probably 2 years or better.
Alfalfa County is already up, but I think they're up with Woods.
So that would make it work
should
a lot quicker.
Faster transition. Now, Bland County, I'm not too sure of. I'm not too sure. But, you know, Alfalfa County is not a very populous county like Bland County, but it would still, the revenue there for the return is pretty good for us.
How hard is it to cut them over to our system?
It's technical. It has to do with, it has to do with a lot of computers, T1 lines, and things I don't understand.
I wish I hadn't asked that question.
All I know is that if a call comes in from Major County, we push a button and send it back to them.
Okay.
To the right place. So
thank you.
That's a pretty good deal. So it is going to be a challenge. Any other questions on 911? Okay, now we go to 51. That's on page 128. This one is a little bit more challenging. What you'll notice is it's going to run a deficit of about $1.747 million this year. The interesting thing is last year we were running a deficit of $1.744, and currently we have that deficit reduced to about $388,000. So, my goal is to take this deficit and make it manageable. We have a pretty healthy fund balance at the moment. We are running short. We're running about 14 short in patrolmen right now. We have 60 patrolmen instead of 74. Pretty much everything in the bottom side, the M&O and CNS, is about the same as last year. Some things that went up a little bit are some of the technological things, because technology costs money. You can buy cheap software, but the support will come back and grab you later. So there are some things. We've got most everything updated this year, all the expensive switches and servers. So, our biggest problem right now that we're facing is manpower. And we will run short this year, be full this year, applicants. So that's going to be a cost savings. We are budgeting at 100% in personnel. So there is some cushion there. So I said my goal is to come in next year, just like this year. I'd like to improve on that $388,000 deficit that we're running right now. So it's going to be a challenging year, but we'll maintain the same service, and we're not going to cut any kind of services at all. And if we get enough people, we can actually expand our services. It's a tough year.
Did I hear you right about 1.177?
1.744 last year, 1.747 this year.
Help me.
On the deficit. It's the difference between the revenues and the expenses. A lot of that, like I said, is personnel costs. Budgeting at 100%. Those are the figures I was given. I don't know if they're on your sheets.
I don't see the.
None of the funds are total.
That's there.
There's not a net figure.
You can see it. You can see it on page 14, Mayor. If you want to look at
no,
that.
No.
Actually, that doesn't.
I've noticed that also. That's kind of make it hard when you're trying to make sure.
Did you say page 14, Gerald?
I did. I thought it was there, but it's not there. It shows the same thing. It shows the expenses and the revenue and the fund balances.
Okay. The $388,000 deficit that we're running right now is just as of this month, or as of April. So, and we're still gonna move forward with changing over our fleet and everything else that we need to do. We're just not gonna make any huge expenses.
Thank you.
Any questions on 51? Moving on to CIC, which is, looks like it's on page 4. This one is a challenge, that's for sure. This was funded through the years and started through the years by a grant from OJA. Everybody knows where grants are going with the state. And they notified us recently that 2017 grant is gone. So, and it was actually $120,000. So we're going to wind up subsidizing CIC. It's a good program, and we're gonna have to basically fully fund them. That have take it out of 51, it's one of the transfers that we do. We transfer to 911 and also CIC. The challenge that we're gonna have is that they're gonna basically run about $117,000 $900 deficit, and that's pretty well gonna eat up their fund balance. The fund balance projected ending fund balance of about $8,000. We'll get through the year. But how we're gonna do that is we're looking at changing hours, and probably we have two openings now, maybe run with those two openings, which will save us on the healthcare costs, which is killing everybody, and also the extra payroll. And since we don't have an OJA grant, we don't necessarily have to run totally by their guidelines, but we still have to run by Title X's guidelines. So what I'm saying is that we don't possibly, we probably will not staff it 4 hours a day as we have. We could close, say, at midnight. We could open at 8 o'clock in the morning, and during the off times have people on call. And it's obviously cheaper to pay on call pay than it is for a full salary. So we'll be able to run that with less people.
Explain what the CIC is, Brian. Right.
CIC, it's a basically a juvenile holding facility.
That's what I thought it was.
They call it the Community Intervention Center. They have fancy names for it, state government. Basically, when an officer brings a child in, unless it's a very serious crime, they're booked into the CIC, which then books them into the OJA system, and they're held there until a parent or guardian comes and picks them up, which basically stops the officer. And I remember being a patrolman a long time ago, that you arrest a kid and you're, you know, say it's a runaway out of Tulsa, and you're sitting there with a kid for 4 hours until mom and dad come over from Tulsa, and you're babysitting a kid. This is the place we put them. They stay there, they're secured, they can't leave. It's very boring for them, which is fine. And then when mom and dad picks them up, they sign them back over to them, and then they get a court date. So it's a good program. And all the CICs, I got a visit from the chief of Woodward PD the other day. They have a CIC over there, and all of a sudden that's getting put on him too. That was funded by the city, and now they want the PD over there to fund the CIC. So he's asking about ours, because it's pretty successful. So we're gonna up our transfer. We transfer $75,000, we're gonna do $95,000, and then we get $40,000 from the city to run the community service aspect of it when we have the kids out, either washing police cars, pulling weeds, and things that they're sentenced to in juvenile court. So I think we can get by. And I know we'll get by this year, and next year we'll take a hard look at it. We'll probably, after July, after we're out from under totally OJA's auspices, then we'll probably look at changing the hours and closing it down, which will be a cost savings, and run it with less people.
Separate this into a separate cost center?
Excuse me, Mayor?
Why do you separate this into a separate cost center?
To a separate cost center? Or a separate fund?
Separate budget item.
Yeah, I think eventually, if I'm right, that this, it probably will go away as a fund and wind up as a line.
Because of the grants?
Because of the grant going away. And I think it'll wind up in the 51 fund. But the grant really doesn't go away until July 1. And we'll have to look at that. Maybe just, will it just have to absorb it to 51, which is fine.
Grants have to go to a specific.
I don't know the the legalities of the grant, but I'm going to guess that it probably has to be tracked very well by OJA.
Right. There's some accounting requirements that say if a certain percentage of your fund is from a special revenue source, which in this case it did qualify, they had to be as a separate fund on our financial statement. So we booked it that way in the budget. We'll look at that to see what the requirements will be going forward on this.
We'll make it work.
Thanks for explaining that, Ryan. I think people listening would like to know what that money, or what that CIC and stuff is.
I forget about the people listening.
Both of them.
Be optimistic. So that's it. That's my four. Is there any other questions that I can answer for anybody?
What happened with your live fire building?
Be optimistic.
Yeah, I can be optimistic. Now, it's not, I'd that still like to idea. Proceed with that at some point in time, but when we first started the budget process and I saw a $2 million deficit is what it started at, that's a little scary, it's a little daunting. And I've talked to the guys about that, and it's not dead by any means. At least I don't feel like it is. I'd like to move forward with it, but I'd like to see where we're gonna go this budget year. You know, I like everybody in the city, I would like to see, you know, sales tax collections start coming up a little bit, or oil fields start back up. And if we get a little bit more optimistic outlook, I'd like to move forward with it because I think it's a really good deal.
That was a $750,000 item, is that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I, you know.
Great if we could fund it.
That would have put, you know, a deficit at well over $2 million. Make it, so it's, you know, we've got the plans for it. We've got the people to run it. Just have to see where we're going. It's a good deal.
And it is a revenue generator.
Yes.
These people would pay to.
It would generate revenue. We would get a percentage. But the offer was a percentage of their profits.
Are we still the only city in Northwest Oklahoma that would offer that?
We would be the only city in the multi-state area to offer that.
Statewide?
More than statewide.
What did your pro forma look like? Would it cover half the expenses or? Two-thirds of it, or do you remember?
We wouldn't really have any expenses. They were going to cover maintenance. I can send that to you. I got an updated one not too long ago. And, you know, it's a revenue end that I'd like to see a little bit bigger.
But I like projects that pay for themselves.
And that it would.
Like it would be one.
It would, but it would take a while. And I think, yeah, I'll send you that, and then you take a look at it and see what their projected profits were. I really don't want to get into that. And see what their projected numbers are and see what our return would be.
Okay. Thank you.
Happy to have you look at it.
If you do, when you send that out, make sure the break-even point is on there. I mean, real clear. That's that in my mind, how long it takes to pay for itself.
It's a good, goodly sized spreadsheet with a lot of numbers, which they're always fun.
Please send that to all of us.
Well,
you want the KISS version.
Yes.
It's not.
I don't know what that is.
Huh?
KISS version?
Yes, sir.
To keep it simple.
Keep it simple.
Oh, yeah, we definitely want that version.
Okay. Yeah, I'll be more than happy to send it. I'll take a look at it.
Great. Thank you.
Mayor Shuey, Commission, Mr. Gilbert, to go over my budget with you. It's pretty plain Jane, pretty simple. I think on the first page of the budget book, you'll see that I'm funding 82 permanent positions. Fully staffed, we have 84 positions. I'm not filling two civilian jobs, that being a support technician, our IT position, and our valve turning position. At the bottom of that first page in the budget book, you can see that being funded really $350,000 less transfer to our account than we did last year. Under personal services, my personal services look like they're going up 2%, and that's mainly due to our health insurance transfer going up $136,000. My actual regular pay to my personnel dropped 1%. Contractual services, I'm budgeting 12% less than last year. And our maintenance and operations, it's 4% less. Would be a little bit less than that, except for they do have a software, online software training program that has to be renewed every 3 years, and it's about a $15,000 expense. Capital outlay of $35,000 in capital outlay for replacement of a staff vehicle. And I want to let you know, with the economy the way it is and revenues, that vehicle probably will not be purchased unless things really make an upturn. Put in the budget basically for $35,000 extra in case something comes up that is unforeseen. It's pretty simple. There's no frills there. It's just getting by and maintaining our operations and keep our personnel at work. I'll entertain any questions.
Keep up the good work.
Thank you, sir.
Anything else on general fund or city business that we want to talk about before we move to EMA? This would be the opportunity on the agenda.
I want to bring one item back up. Unfortunately, that last meeting was scheduled for an hour and I had to go at 1 o'clock. I thought the issues raised about the PR department is worthy of going back to. Is this the appropriate time, Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
I think there was kind of a challenge thrown out that the money we're spending on the PR department was excessive or inappropriate. To compare today's PR department to the previous Pegasus and its expenditures is like comparing a Model A Ford to a brand new Ferrari. I mean, those are not even remotely the same issues. When we had Pegasus before, we were spending $185,000, that's true, but that was nowhere near the whole story. The rest of that story was we still had a PR department on top of that, which was anywhere from 75 to 100 grand. We were paying studio utilities and rent. We did outside contracting. So for a crappy show with a cat in the studio in an old building full of asbestos that we eventually knocked down, we were spending $300,000 a year for a Model A. Today, the PR budget is $511,000. $416,000 of that is personnel. What we have today doesn't even remotely compare to what we had with Pegasus. That PR budget includes all of the ETN, all of the internet services, the high definition TV studio, two HD channels that are on 24/7, and we don't have a cat. We have 7 weekly programs. Just looking at trying to run those numbers in terms of if we still had Pegasus and we had to contract out just the 7 weekly programs that we have, if you pick a mid-range number in terms of what private video production costs are, which range anywhere from $75 an hour to $200 an hour, if you add the hours up just simply from those 7 weekly programs, we're getting $285,000 worth of value out of those weekly programs. So if you add MAPC, study sessions, city council meetings, and all that back into it for another $25,000 to $100,000, that's not even counted in the budget, and then you've still got the salaries of public relations. Sure, we put out water bulletins and street closings, but that is not what this PR department is completely about. So I kind of took offense to what I read in the paper and then what I watched on the program in the next 20 minutes after I left at 1 o'clock. And I want to say that I think public relations department, the marketing department, the television studio and the internet services that we now have are probably one of the best in the Midwest, if not the best in the country for a city this size. And that $511,000 in my mind is well spent. I don't want the public to think that Pegasus and the current PR department are even in the same category with each other. That's well spent money, and I don't want to see us make any change to that PR budget.
It's a little hard to compare though, David, because the biggest change from the Pegasus days to ETN was at least my impression of the programs that actually are watched, was the change to HD broadcast. But that's not any great feat of ours. Pegasus saved up money that we paid them for several years so they could do that. It was going to happen whether we took them out or not. I also quibble a little bit with your comparison of a Model A versus a Ferrari. At some point, you don't need a Ferrari, you need a Subaru. And more importantly, sometimes all we can afford is the Model A, and all we need is, you know, is an old station wagon. I'm not sure that we need a Ferrari of a television station, especially when the vast majority of those programs, at least from the only metric that we have in terms of YouTube views, nobody's watching them. We're in 20 views, if we're lucky, 40 views. Our meetings get watched, but I know it's really hard to measure because there's no way to do it. Who is watching it on Suddenlink? And that's a problem that I wish we had a better solution for. I think we'd all be happier if we knew how many hours of programming were actually getting watched. But, you know, we do have a metric via the YouTube views, and it's nothing. I don't want to pay $285,000 for programming that nobody's watching. I missed that discussion. I had strep throat. I wasn't here. Maybe there was more depth there, but it's an awful lot of money. And I think perhaps the attention to the bottom line number arises out of the promise that we were made that taking over Pegasus would cost less money. And it hasn't. In any scenario, there's no way you cut that it costs less money. I mean, we were promised that we would take over Pegasus, we would take the fund balance they had, we would make the same investments they were going to do, and then the operating cost would decrease. But the operating cost has increased by a couple $100,000 a year. And last year, when we had the same discussion in budget cycle last year, and I brought up those same numbers, and we had the same discussion, and nothing changed, I would have liked to see something improve.
I beg your pardon. David, I agree with you. Wait till I'm through.
Okay.
We rolled the marketing expense, the personnel, and the PR expense into this account, which we already had that expense in the city budget anyway. Correct?
Correct, sir.
If I'm wrong.
That is correct.
We had them. We have them now. The marketing department and the PR department and the Enid Television Network handles more than just the city of Enid. It is the marketing arm for the city of Enid. Who else is going to market the city of Enid? We've got to market ourselves. I know that $551,000 or whatever the figure is not what we were going to do with just the Pegasus system alone. You add those two salaries and fringe benefits in, you're probably looking at $150,000 that you can subtract off of that figure. I don't know. I don't know what the salaries are.
So we're also paying ERDA and ECBB to...
Pardon me?
We're also paying the Enid Regional Development Alliance to market Enid to one subset. We're paying the Convention Visitors Bureau to market Enid to another subset. We have Main Street that markets Enid to yet another.
I understand that. They market their own little niche.
No, the Enid Convention and Visitors Bureau's job is to market the whole entire city of Enid to the rest of the world. That's what they're there for.
I agree.
I mean, that's their job, and that's a whole separate pile of money, which is well spent. And I agree, the television network that we're getting is a million times better than what we had before. But I still have issues with the PR part of the PR department, because I don't feel like we're getting that. I don't think we're getting good public relations for what we're doing with the citizens of our community, and I think that's what the PR job should be.
I have had, Tammy, I've never heard that from any.
Pretty shows every morning.
I have never heard that comment from anybody.
Well, you heard it from me.
That's one.
Mayor, I'll second that.
Wait. Mayor, I may.
Yes. Well, we will not interrupt you.
Okay. David, you know, I'm the one that challenged this in the meeting that you're referring to. And my main reason for doing that is I don't have any big problem with the work they're doing. But I do have a problem with the fact that we don't have any money to pave streets this year, but we've got $500,000 to spend on public relations. And I just think that we need to do a better job of prioritizing. what we're spending the taxpayers' money on. And so, that's why I think we need to take a hard look at some of these things like that. It's nice, and like you say, I don't understand what they're running on Channel 11. I've tried to watch some of that, and it's a bunch of old black and white movies that you can't even hardly understand. They're grainy, and the sound's not good. It appears to me that channel could probably go dark and wouldn't be a great deal missed. But it's the idea that I just want us to look at our infrastructure issues and the things that we need to spend money on before we spend money on public relations and a television program. So,
Commissioners, I thought that this might come up again. So we did prepare some numbers, and the numbers did surprise me that, yes, we are spending a little bit more, but it's not as much as I thought. And so, Aaron, we'll pass that out just for your consumption throughout the rest of this budget process. I do, too, appreciate the comments of Dr. Van Hooser about the PR department and mayor. I know that there's areas we can do better in. I've heard that. I understand that. I think I appreciate Commissioner Brownlee's comments from the meeting we had last week. And that we're working to improve in that public relations area to try and fill in, because I think everybody, it sounds like, agrees that the television production stuff is far superior to what we've ever had. When you take a look at those numbers, it was more than, we talk about $185,000. It was more than $185,000 for Pegasus. So, yeah, that was the TV part. We did have marketing webmaster people before. We had those expenses, like was mentioned, and we also transferred Pegasus additional money to work on their high definition stuff. So I was surprised when that came up to $458,000. When we cut over in 2013, yes, it was actually lower, which I think gives some credence to the claim that we could do it for less.
In what year, Drew?
That was 2013-14. I think the very next year, we had some significant expenses, and we got the Pegasus leftover money that had been accumulating for HD stuff, and it was used for a remodel there at the studio so that we have what we have today to produce those shows. And it has gone up gradually. You are correct in that. And in particular, but actually, if you look at the 12-13 year, when it was 479 last year, the current year that we're in was 471, and 511 is an increase. So I am sensitive to the comments, Commissioner Jansen, you made, too. I think you're right. It's tough to balance the priorities, especially when there's less money. So, I think that staff assisting me to present this budget, I think we've done a relatively good job, and I think that's where we rely on you to help us fix the priorities if they're not right. So that's what I wanted to say about that.
Gerald? I agree with you completely, Ron. Every single fund in this budget is up for discussion, and I don't disagree with you there. What I guess I took issue to was there was sort of the implication that a promise was made that we would operate Pegasus for less money in the future. That's why I use the analogy of a Model A and a Ferrari. These are not the same two animals. We're not operating Pegasus anymore, and we've combined so many things that that's not even a fair comparison. There were no broken promises here. This is a different deal. And I mean, to have the daily shows and things that are on ETN, I don't know what the value of that is, Ben. I don't know that you can measure it by YouTube counts by any means. I get more comments than ever before about how many people watch the things that are on there. Every one of us has been on a show or two or three. We've had the lieutenant governor, we've had celebrities. I mean, what city does that? So how much that's worth in terms of marketing, I don't know. But we're getting it very, very cheaply. For that, I told you, just those seven weekly programs, if we farmed them out, let's say it's the old Pegasus system, and we decided we still wanted to have those seven programs the way we have them, that cost us $285,000. What it really costs us, based on our highest paid ETN employee, is it costs us $38,000 to produce $285,000 worth of work. If that's not value, I don't know what is. So you're right, this fund and every other fund, we can question all we want to whether that's the best priority use, but it's just not right to compare this to Pegasus and to say that we've broken a promise on that, because we have not. We have a product that is not even the same.
David, one thing too, while you mentioned something there that I'm kind of concerned about. We also moved the school broadcasting back to the school system. I mean, Pegasus once upon a time did broadcast Enid High School sporting events, which I don't know whether that's being done now or not. And I know that Channel 19 at some point, I guess, is going to start doing that again. And the other thing that I know some people have commented to me that they do miss, that had broadcast in the past, things like downtown festivals and parades and things like that, that Pegasus produced, which, you know, are not being shown anymore. So, you know, there's...
Well, we allowed for that, and they're not taking advantage of it. That's the $10,000 that we brought up the other day when I asked Steve, you know, is somebody using that? And those same programs, Tri-State, Chautauqua, and so forth, we perfectly can do if somebody asks us to do them. We have the funds in addition to what we're... I mean, that's within the budget to cover those, and there just hasn't been the request. So if there's something the commission wants to do,
they were required to go and produce it themselves and then take it to the...
I think there's a big misunderstanding of how this all works.
Yeah.
That's a combination thing. We can simply, they can request that we cover it and we use it, we do that out of the $10,000, or we can hire it out based on their request and use some of that money. I mean, it's very open to what the public wants. And my understanding is we really only had one significant request that we've covered for that. If this commission wants something in particular covered, we should tell Steve and he'll get it done, I'm sure. But it's just such a different animal. I just didn't want to let that one lie. I don't know that anybody's really suggesting we change that budget, and I'm certainly not. But I just felt like the characterization of what we had done, I kind of take it personally because I felt like I drove that pretty hard to get rid of Pegasus, if that's the right word, and get what we have today. And I'm very proud of what we have today. And PR department is not about water bulletins and street closings. It's about the way we look to the community. And to be able to get on the internet from wherever I was that day that I sat and watched you guys for 3 hours with a rum drink in my hand with my feet up at the side of the pool, I mean, what cities get that? That's incredible. And so I think that's well worth the money. And I'll get off my soapbox now.
Well, I have, go ahead. I have a question of David.
The thing is, I appreciate the television station, and I think it's great. But I do think that the community would like to see our annual events like Tri-State and like the Cherokee Strip Parade and like those things. I think those things should just be a given. I don't think we should have to ask for our community's events to be broadcast. I think they just should be, because that's what people, I mean, that, a lot of people like to watch that stuff. I mean, there are a few that are just annual that are always going to happen. Chautauqua, Cherokee Strip, Tri-State, whatever. I mean, I think those should just be an annual thing on the list. And if that means only doing 3 shows a week, then cut it down to 3 shows a week. I don't think that should take up $10,000 out of, I mean, a special budget to do that, because to me, that is what part, that's what you should be doing, is doing things that the community is involved in and interested in.
I have a question of David when you're through.
Yes, sir.
When we had Pegasus, weren't there 3 channels involved with Pegasus?
Yes, sir.
And they converted into the Indian Television Network. Well, 11 and 12, and 19 was set aside for
school.
Indian Public Schools. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. Yeah, that's right. And we,
so
we converted 19 to HD, and then we gave it to the school system because they wanted to control it so they could do football games and they wanted to do some classes. And actually, I've never watched 119, so I don't know what's on it.
I have.
Are they doing something with it? I hope they are.
It's basically school buildings.
Okay. Well, it's up to them. It's out of our, it doesn't cost us a dime. I mean,
what about 11?
11 is the non-government channel. It's the community channel. So you see those old movies a lot of times. It's later at night, but there's other community-produced programming on there and other stuff that's not specifically government-related. The government-related stuff, these kind of shows, City Connections, Good Morning Nina, that stuff is on Channel 12 or 112 in high def.
If you pull out the 2 salaries of the marketing and the PR personnel, you're less than what Pegasus was for the 2011 and 12 and 2012 and 13.
I agree. It's
my rough guess is $150,000 for those 2 salaries and fringe benefits. Subtract $150,000 from 511, it'll be $458 and $479. And they're promoting the city of Enid constant.
I agree.
Do we still have an advisory board?
Pardon me?
Do we still have a Pegasus advisory, or sorry, ETN advisory board?
We do still have a board. We have not met in a long, long time. It's my understanding, Dr. V could probably give more input on that, It's my understanding that board was created. It was created to assist with the transfer over from Pegasus and help us with some specifications on equipment and things like that. We haven't had a meeting since whenever we had the last meeting, but there's nothing to say that we can. In fact, this is on the study session for tomorrow to talk about boards and commissions. And if that's one that you want us to start having meetings on and maybe redirect some things, I'm open to that, certainly.
I've had some input from people on the board that wonder why they haven't met anymore, because that wasn't necessarily there.
There really hadn't been an issue. I kind of looked at the board once we got the ETN up and so forth, is to help decide kind of what the programming should be, and maybe that's a good place, as you said, Commissioner Wilson, to bring in some of the projects that we want to cover going forward. But Channel 111 and 11, you're right, Mayor, it's very underutilized. I mean, one of the things we offered to the public 2 years ago when we made the transition was, you can produce anything you want to and we'll put you on TV for free. We'll even help you produce your program in our studio. For a while, we offered open afternoons, if I'm not mistaken, for people to come in and use our equipment with some supervision at no cost. And that's just not been utilized. So I'm not sure what the demand is. There's a demand out there for those programs to be published. And then that gets into the issue of, well, some of them may be inappropriate to place on public television. And that, to me, was where the advisory board would be very beneficial to say, you know, this is not content that we want to put on. And we can certainly call a meeting, but I haven't had a need, but I think it's probably a good idea. We probably need to call that together and let's have them look at the programming, see if they would recommend changes, and we can sure look at them, because it's a great, great asset that we're really underutilizing from the public standpoint. But what Steve and his department is doing is, I mean, you really ought to look at the list of those shows before you criticize what's on there. It is incredible. The City Connections and all the how-tos, water department videos, and there's, I bet half the employees have had their own 15-minute show about what it is they do. Whether anybody's watching that or not, I don't know, but it's there. You know, I've never been in the library and there's a gazillion books in there to read. Well, that doesn't mean the library is a bad thing. It just means I don't go in there. So there's no reason why we can't have a library of things about the city and for the city in high quality like we have, that we should kick it out just because there's a few YouTube, you know.
We don't even have 2 years worth of experience.
Yeah.
Well, maybe we need to do some PR about what is available to the public, because I don't think that the public knows all that's available.
Right. That's a good point.
It's a good point.
I don't think people know how that reflects. To do a show works. I wasn't even clear on how that works. I think the public should probably, I mean, I
think. Thank you, Mayor, for allowing me to bring that up again.
Mayor, I'd like to go if you don't mind.
Sorry, Ed.
You know how much.
You're next.
I love to listen and go last, but.
Might not be last.
Well, I'm going to try. First of all, Gerald, Aaron, whomever prepared this spreadsheet, thank you, because maybe this is the first step at putting this whole Pegasus ETN debate to rest.
My staff prepared that this afternoon.
Thank you.
I didn't hear what you said.
My staff prepared that this afternoon for
tonight. There is no longer an argument that it's a money issue. Now, we can always try to talk about a Subaru if you want to talk about a Subaru or a Porsche or whatever, but the fact is things have changed quite a bit and the money layout really hasn't. So I'm very pleased with that. over the last 10 minutes, we've sat here and we've talked about what has happened with marketing and PR, not what is going to happen. Marketing is a challenge because it's all intangible. And we have police, they protect people, and fire, that puts out fire, and we've got capital improvement projects that we get to fund and we budget for and we see them come to fruition. Those are all tangible items. Marketing and PR isn't. And the challenge with that fund or with that department is we have to be focused on what is coming instead of what has happened. So I'm particularly curious and I'm excited, Gerald, I'm speaking to you, that I do think we have made some progress, a lot of progress through the years, and I do think it's a good department, but I do think we've made some progress in setting some objectives for that department to meet. We've talked about press conferences, we've talked about being more proactive and transparent with the delivery of some of our information. disseminating the weekly manager report. We've talked about just the relationships with newspaper and other media outlets, and regardless of how you may or may, regardless of how you feel about the TV aspect of it, we can assign a value to that. But if we can achieve those objectives that we've set forth after the retreat, that's worth quite a bit of money. And that will help all of our constituency be better informed, and those of us that are sitting up here work through issues with less challenge and better transparency. So I'm in favor of the budget, but I'm looking more forward than I am backward. And I'm hopeful that that we can achieve some of those objectives that you all have already, or that we've discussed and that you've already discussed with them.
Good point, but I agree. Good point. Anyone else?
Not on this particular item, but I do. Are we open on all the general fund items? Is that what
yes, sir.
We're talking about? I want to bring up something that I brought up at the previous meeting, and just in way of taking action on it. I brought up the ROGO contract, $48,000 that we're spending on Mr. ROGO. I like Mr. ROGO. He's a very nice young man. He comes here once or twice a year and tells us what legislation has been introduced in Oklahoma City. And we get that same information from the OML. And I've brought this up every year since I've been on this commission, and I would feel like I had missed an opportunity if I didn't make a motion on it now. I'd like to make a motion that we do away with that contract and save $48,000 a year. If nobody agrees with me, we'll save it again till next year.
And just
hearing none.
And just for the sake of brevity, I'll be as quick as Ron. I'd really like to ditch OML. I think we get nothing for it except a newsletter. It's a lot of money. We have to pay for the trainings that we do through OML anyway. It is a glorified social club for city officials. I have, excuse me, their lobbying will continue for municipal causes, whether we are a member or not. We have a lobbyist in Kurt Rogo. If we're going to have a lobbyist, let's stick with one and save OML. I would move we stop paying the OML contract every year. Any bites?
I happen to be on the OML board.
I know.
And I have been 3 years. We have not had a seat at the table in years and years and years. I will be the president of that board come September. I haven't seen anything of what you said.
But Mayor, and I appreciate that your involvement, and certainly hope that we get more value with your involvement than we have in past years. But in the time I've been here, I don't know what we bought or the check we write every year. I haven't seen any concrete benefit. I also make this in much like Ron every year and have obvious optimism but little expectation.
Well, Ben, I don't know that I necessarily have an opinion on OML. I can share an opinion on ROGO, and we don't hear from him enough, probably. When we do, it's fairly lengthy, and I'm not sure that I have energy to listen to it all. I don't mean that disrespectfully, but there's just a lot going on. But I can tell you that I know that he spends time on priorities. I know that he and Brent talk often, and I'm appreciative for his efforts, and thankful. I'm proud to be part of the group that didn't second that.
I have been to the Capitol six different times this year, and I saw him all six times. He's down there a lot more.
I don't doubt that he goes there.
And lobbyists work the legislators.
But the one thing I've asked for every year and I have yet to receive is for him to come here with one specific thing that Enid would not have gotten without Kurt Rogan. Just bring me that. One thing, and I'll shut up for the rest of my 3 years.
On that issue,
wait a minute. Wait till Ron's through. Wait till Ron's through.
No, that was it.
Unwind him, Aaron.
I'm trying.
No, but so if someone sees him, and of course, don't tell me about something you did 5 years ago. I want to know what you did last year. We paid you $48,000 last year, or this current fiscal year. So anyway.
Well, I'm
ready to move on to one other item.
If you're ready to move on,
I want to hear what Gerald has to say.
I just wanted to say that, I got to say, Commissioner Jansen, I was skeptical myself of the value that we get from a Kurt Rogo.
more so probably than OML, but I will tell you that since I've been city manager, I've become convinced of the value. Sometimes it's hard to see, but you kind of challenged me with one thing, and yes, maybe I'm going to go back 5 years ago, but I remember, it actually wasn't even 5 years ago, when he was here, one of the last times he was here, talked about, because of his relationship as a former legislator, knowing the person that handled the House agenda floor, you'll remember that sales tax retention that just passed last year. I know that's, you knew that was what I was going to come back with.
That's the only one I've ever heard. That's the only one I've ever heard, and I think that would have happened even without.
Well, you just asked for one.
No. I've already heard that. And I don't think he was totally responsible.
Anyway,
I'll be quiet. It's not going to get it. Not going to make it this year. You can prepare yourself for next year.
My thought is we would be conspicuous by our absence.
You think?
Yes, sir.
A couple of
not having our lobbyists down there.
You think every other city has got one?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
I've been down there 6 times this year.
Seen them all. It must be a bunch of them.
They don't have the they don't have their city name on their label. Their bell.
A couple of other less contentious items. Here under Public Works Management, and we may have touched on this, but I was curious looking here on page 61, the budget. I went through all of these departments, and all of them had an increase, of course, in their health insurance transfer and their pension benefits. Why under Public Works was it 150% increase and 110% increase, which that one department was just way out of line with everything else.
Right, absolutely. When we looked at that budget and compared it to what we had budgeted last year, there were only 2 positions in that department. And one of the 2 positions was vacant at the time that we approved the budget last year. And as we filled that position and then relocated one other position from Fleet into this budget, that's why there's such the percentage skewed so highly when there's only 3 employees there.
Okay, I guess that makes sense. One other item, if I may. Gerald, you can tell me this. Do we have an event, the recreation program coordinator on staff now?
We actually do have one hired. He is starting May 23rd or so, Billy. Is that right? His name is Courtney Tenniel, and he is currently teaching the Tulsa Public School Systems. We're very excited about him. He's done coaching. He's a former OU and Tulsa football player. I think he's going to hopefully fit in well with the events and the recreation as we try to improve our efforts in that area. So, yes, we have him hired. He's just not here yet.
Can we keep this one for?
I think so. I think we've got I think we've got a good one, and Ms. Tammy, please help me with that regard.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Onward and upward.
Did we, since the last meeting, discuss the fleet management with the NAPA? See how we want to go about with that?
I think with the NAPA, I think what we would like to do is come back at a study session after we get past the budget and visit about that. I think that I have concerns. And we've talked about this before, but one of my concerns too is being careful in if we do look at that item and decide that something else might be appropriate. I want to be careful to remember that we came from having 2 employees there with certain costs, and there were certain reasons we thought we could save money. We thought we would improve in customer service, and I think now it's fair to go back and analyze that and see if those things are really happening. So I think to answer your question, it's on my list of things to come back to you with. Currently in the budget, we would, regardless of whether we have NAPA or somebody else, we're still going to need budgeted monies to buy those parts and supplies. But I'm thinking this one's pretty high on the list to be coming back soon. Well, that's one of the things that I'm concerned about. I know that Aaron has had meetings with staff already. Billy, you've been in some of those. I think Lou has. And really looking at it and talking about things like the quality, the cost, are we getting that savings? I believe it's one of those things that's hard to tell, like we were just talking about. I believe on certain items we clearly save money, auto parts being one of them. That's what they specialize in. I think there's certain things that we probably don't, and I think we got to look at that sum, and then we've got to figure out, which is one of the issues that we have now, if we change the model that we have. One of the benefits that we have of NAPA is they own the inventory, They manage the inventory, they keep track of it, they deal with all that. One of our problems before when we dealt with it was inventory. And so that's something that I would like to get a good answer for before we come back and talk to you about any potential proposal to change that.
How many years have we had this?
About 2 years, or maybe it's been three already. It's been three.
Something like
November of 13 or so, maybe 12 or 13.
I guess it would be 2 years. I don't know.
When does this come up? Yearly contract?
Their contract, I don't know exactly when. I do know that we have the ability to terminate that with a certain amount of notice. I don't want to say what those days are because I don't have them in my head, but I was satisfied when I looked at it that it's something like 90 or 120 days, I believe, is what it is.
I'd like to know how much time, how many years we've been in existence.
I think maybe, Aaron, your stellar staff can probably figure that out while we talk about other budget items and come back to that.
Looks like we saw a presentation in September of 13 on it. I don't know if we decided.
So we would have started in
12-13 is last year that we had warehouse budget, or after that it would have been Napa.
So I think we cut over then in November of 13. Is that when you?
November of 12.
Maybe we're looking at a year in.
We've had three years.
Yeah, I think we were still in the RFP process in September of 13.
Commissioner, we will be bringing it back, I'm sure, to a study session very soon.
Good.
Anything else before we move on?
There's nothing else, so we're ready to move on to.
May I go to item three? We will now adjourn to convene as the Enid Municipal Authority. All of the trustees of the Enid Municipal Authority are in attendance at the special meeting. Item five, the Enid Municipal Authority special meeting is now in session. Item six, discuss and take necessary action on the fiscal year 2016-2017 Enid Municipal Authority financial plan. Aaron?
Page 154 is where we start with EMA. Overall revenue is budgeted at $38,558,675. And of that, there's two main sources that make that up. We basically have utility fees and we have sales tax. Utility fees make up about 72% of that total revenue number, $27.6 million. And sales tax makes up the other 28, or about $10.8 million of that. As we look at each kind of separate category there on revenues, you can see water, we budgeted $11 million this year. We're projecting to come in around 14. We're still budgeting that 11. This is just that 1 year run behind on Coke that we've talked about several times. As we've done financial updates, we still anticipate there's been some decreased usage even the last couple of weeks with Coke on the water usage there and an increase in the reuse water. Also going through stormwater, we're coming in a little higher this year than what we budgeted, and we've increased that line $50,000 for next year. Landfill, we're coming in significantly higher, but we only did bump that up 75. That's another, we're having some fees are one time based on Coke expansion that we don't expect to have going forward. Trash for residential, commercial, and sewer services and sewer improvement, we budgeted flat. They're coming in about right where we are. A little bit of increase and decrease between each of those lines, but overall we're about there. Miscellaneous is a big decrease based on some land and things that we were going to sell in the budget this year, and then not planning on those for next year, and we'll see where that pans out as the year goes on. Grant revenue, we did have some money budgeted this year to receive in grant revenue, and actually received it within the last week of June the year before that, so that's why there's no grant money actually coming in this year on that line. And then sales tax transfers, you can see, are coming in down. We actually project that they're going to be a little bit up in this one, the reallocation of the sales tax and how that was updated based on the audit recommendations, gave us a slight increase in this one, and this is the 1% for the capital improvement and the 2003 school bond. As we move on, H-155, 156, we talked about expenses.
And I have a question.
Yes.
This is comparing the budget that we have for 2015-16 to 2016-2017. How does that compare to actual?
Okay, so on the slide that's up
in front of you. I know we're not through with 2016.
Right. On the slide that's up in front of you on the revenues, you can see the blue line is what we budgeted. That was the adjusted budget. So that includes what was approved, any increases or decreases during the year. The red line is actually where we're coming in this year, where we're projecting that we're going to end. And the green is where we're budgeting for next year.
It's useful.
First time Fed's ever been positive.
It's only in water sales, though.
Do what?
It's only in water sales.
Yeah. Right. Everything else is pretty level. Except miscellaneous.
Correct.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Expenses, page 155 and 156. There is one small change revision that has happened since you originally got your budget, and that is an increase in the transfer line of $10,250, and that's related to a grant. We got some further clarification on a safe route to school grant this week, and what it means is that we got $41,000 more in grant revenue, but we also have to pay our 20% match on that, which equated to $10,250 more, so that we can utilize that additional $41,000 in funds. So we do the breakdown and look at it overall. Personnel comes up to 11.8%, contractual services 14.7%, M&O 6.6%, capital LA 22.9%, and transfers of 44%. And this is kind of a comparison of the same thing, where the blue is the adjusted budget for this year, and then we're looking at red is the projection of where we're coming in, and the green with where we're proposing to budget next year. Personnel, you can see overall is up 423. Of that 423, about $184,000 of that is due to that 27th payroll. About $169,000 is due to increase in health cost, pushing that burden back onto the funds instead of the health fund budget or in their reserves that they did have. And then there's an increase of about $70,000 in retirement to help fund that actuary projection there. As we go through and look at contractual services, there are mostly some decreases there. There are a couple of increases. There's a decrease in some school bond expense of $209,000. That's due to sales tax revenues coming in lower, so what we pay out to the schools in that instance is lower. Decrease in utility cost of $136,000. And then some smaller decreases in equipment maintenance and some equipment rental fees from last year's budget and an increase in royalty payments. M&O, there's a slight decrease overall. It was really hard to figure out exactly. There's a lot of moving around within the M&O budget. As we had a new director come in, he really scrutinized what his people had in their lines and kind of did a lot of moving around from maybe a tools, parts, and supplies line down to a computer line of how they could do things more efficiently and what they really needed there. Capital outlay, you'll see there's a huge decrease. That decrease is due to debt payments. If you'll remember, we did have the 1987A bond that extinguished in this fiscal year, this last fiscal year, and so that payment was about $4.2 million that we don't have going forward. There's a slight increase adding the 2015 note for the capital items that we did debt finance in the current fiscal year that we're in. And then transfers overall is some up and some down. We'll go to the next slide and kind of talk about breakout of that. This is the EMA operations budget. This is where the majority of the money in EMA goes out through or out through. Page 162. That contractual services line, you can see where we originally budgeted versus the adjusted budget is the same there. Where we're proposing from next year, that 209 down is that 8% decrease in sales tax that we're projecting out. You see there's increases in two funds as far as transfers go. One is to general fund, that is to help offset the decrease in sales tax revenue, and that increase is $1.64 million. And then there's an increase also of $50,000 in the stormwater fund, and that's tied directly to the fees. And so when we raise the stormwater fees on the revenue side, that also has to come and be transferred out to stormwater fund on that side of it. Other than that, there's decreases, and we'll get into that tomorrow night as Chris goes through all of the slides from engineering on what the projects are funding on all these numbers that are going out of this fund. Overall decrease on the debt payments there is $4.3 million. Other than that, we have all the departments that operate within the EMA operations. We have utility services. There, you can see they're trending in a little bit low this year. And next year, they're only showing a slight increase due to personnel. They have a 6% increase in personnel. Other than that, there was some moving around between some M&O and contractual services. There was increase in postage and some splice kits that they needed to do. And then there was a decrease in some maintenance that they were paying on an insert machine that's now in the accounting department that we use for payroll and checks. So that expense moved to accounting whenever that moved. And solid waste, so move to the next one. They're on page 166. Overall, they have an increase in personnel of 4%, $58,550. The other piece that makes up their personnel is they do have one vacant commercial operator or commercial collector position that they did remove from this budget for next year. There's a decrease in the line for dozers, for their rentals on their dozer and compactor. We had budgeted that a little higher last year than when it actually came in when we did the bids this year, so we got to lower that line about $45,000 there. And then there's some increase in waste fees that we're having to pay at the landfill, or to the state from the landfill. There's a decrease in M&O for some roll-off and dumpster containers that were replaced this year that don't need to be in the budget next year, and that's about $40,000. There's some other decreases in diesel. We're replacing our notification system from Blackboard, and we're going to be looking at Nixle product, which is what emergency management uses currently, and that's going to save about $20,000 a year. And then we're also some one-time replacements they needed to do there with cameras and signs that are, again, one-time things that were $14,600. So those are the main highlights from solid waste, unless you have anything specific on that budget. Okay, public utilities management is on page 169. They overall had an increase of 13% in personnel, or $34,075. And this is another one where we had a vacant position budgeted, so that's why that increase is a little higher than the 6 or 7 that we've been seeing. And there's a slight decrease in the vehicle lines. They just have maybe newer vehicles, or we overestimated what we thought they were going to need to maintain their vehicles in that department. Water production, it's page 172. They have a 6% increase in personnel, $41,915. Other than that, they have increases in royalties, and we did add a $20,000 line this year that previously hasn't been there for emergency rentals on generators in case we need it during ice storms or what other events may happen, that we would have to come back in that those circumstances to use that money if we need to be able to do that in a timely fashion. Decreasing utilities here, $47,000, and M&O increase of $25,000. Not sure. There was a lot of moving around, so if there's specific questions on that, Lou's here would be able to help with anything there if you have questions. Water reclamation is on page 175. This one, we have an increase of 7% in personnel, $66,655. Overall, there's a big decrease in utilities. This is one where we split out bills and between water reclamation and wastewater and just still hadn't quite got that split right. And so you'll see that there's a decrease in this budget, but there's an increase in wastewater management. Overall, between the two, it's still a decrease of about $60,000 in utility cost. Other than that, they just moved around a bunch of stuff between lines. Wastewater plant management, you'll see that there's a pretty big increase in this budget. It's on page 178. The increase to utilities here is the $92,000. That's 92 of what was basically budgeted in water reclamation last year of that 170. So as we look to do that going forward, hopefully we have the split right now on what items go to which departments. There's an increase in blower repair cost. Typically, in the past, we have not budgeted for that line item, but that's become apparent that we need to put in some maintenance dollars to maintain those blowers. We have one that we have out to repair right now, and it would be prudent for us to get the others that are out fixed so that we have those as to take out the other ones in service that need to be fixed as well. The one that we're looking to get fixed right now is about $25,000, and so it's not going to take much to go through all that blower money, and I do think it is a necessary thing that we do need to add to the budget. They also have a $10,000 increase in there for some servers. Their SCADA software is ran on a single server, and those servers are to the point that they need to be replaced. And then they have a slight increase in chemicals and a decrease overall in fuel in that department. Then we have the capital replacement budget, which is on page 182. This year we budgeted $561,000. We're projecting to spend $668,000. We had some things come up this year that we needed to take care of, and one of them being that blower repair that we talked about that wasn't budgeted for. Another thing that came up was compactors over at the new Stone Bridge Apartments. They requested to do compactors over there, and we didn't have money budgeted for that, so that's something else. And then we did purchase a jetter trailer, which is some equipment that allows our staff to fix some smaller breaks and things that we previously had bid out and had outsourced, and that we believe that we have the staff and capabilities to do in-house and save some money there on those. As far as next year's budget, you can see that's an increase again, and there are very specific items. The whole list of what they are is on page, is it 182?
Yes.
Okay, and there are the items that are there. Diamond replacement, that was an item that was presented in last year's budget and ended up on the deferred list. So that's the first that's the only one on this list that did get cut and was deferred last year. And again, that's the software that runs our utility billing and all of our receiving for that. It runs code, it runs our business licenses, and it ties in with our financial software. So it's a very important piece of software that we use, and I think it's worthy of the money that it would take and the effort from staff to get that in place. So we have some reporting. Excuse me. There's Neptune is the software that runs our water meter infrastructure, and so all the readings come into that server so that we can do the billing, and it's time to do an upgrade according to IT on that server. We have a couple of balers for the recycle center. From what I understand, and Lou can correct me if I'm wrong here, but I think they're both down right now and they're having to do a lot of stuff manually. And if we're looking to expand recycling and get some of those waste fees to go down, this is what we need to do and replace so that we can get started on something to make efforts there. There are four trucks that we budgeted. All of these vehicles that we're replacing have close to 100,000 miles. Most of them are 95, 96 models that we're replacing on there. There's one new truck that is not going to be a replacement, which is the truck that's going to pull the jetter trailer, and it will be attached to it permanently, so we're not having to hook and unhook it to move it around like we do right now. Other than that, we have a solid waste truck. We got a request for five. We were able to get one. And then we have a mule, I think, that will be used at the landfill, from what I understand. So those are the items that we were able to fund, or that we felt would be the best use of the money that we could put into capital for these operational departments for this next year. Is there any questions on anything that has to do with EMA?
Mayor, one item, if I may, and maybe we've covered this and I missed it, but here on page 155, the health insurance and the pension transfers, is that going to be an annual transfer in that amount, or is that a one-time deal?
No, those would be annual amounts. Those are tied to employees, and so based on number of employees, those are benefits that run through on the payroll side and are transferred for health to the health fund to pay out those claims and for pension.
But they're significantly higher this year than they were the previous year.
Correct. Previously for retirement, we had funded at a level of about 6.5% of payroll into that retirement. And whenever we met with our actuary for our annual investment meeting this year, they actually came back with a number of over $1 million that they said we needed to fund, which we were currently funding about $600,000 a year. And so we didn't feel we could come up to $1 million. We looked at doing something in the neighborhood of $850,000 as far as funding and trying to keep that fund in a place where the net pension is not growing every year, the net pension liability. The health fund, last year we made a conscious decision, and when we did the 5% across the board cut to personnel, that also reduced 5% of the funding that was going to health fund. Health fund did last year have a fund balance to be able to sustain that, but they don't have the ability going forward to keep sustaining those hits. So that burden was pushed back onto each of those departments. So when you look at the cumulative for EMA, which they have 75 employees in EMA, it's a bigger number.
So you think it'll be about the same next year as it is this year? Do you think it'll be another $200,000 increase?
I don't think it'll be 200, but I do think that we'll have to wait and see what our RFP comes back with on our health and see what our actuary says about how our pension plan has performed in the last year to see where we're at.
I wonder if we shouldn't consider raising employee contributions on those issues. If we're going to go that far down, you know that.
We have, and I think we'll get into some more discussions tomorrow night on health. We have two health plans for employees. One of those health plans, Plan A, I believe, is the one that's employee contributions are going up 10%. Plan B is going to stay the same. Its rates are higher already. And there's some other changes related to a preferred network and things like that. And if you guys have had a chance, we've already sent you the health presentation, so you've got a chance to look at that. But we'll talk about that more in depth tomorrow. Just to follow up on what Aaron said, can't really make a prediction. It's hard to do. If I could do that, certainly I'd be probably wherever Dr. V was with his feet up watching TV. Probably not eating TV, though. Although it's a wonderful product. I don't think they'll be that great. I think that some of the actions that we've taken this year, I don't think the percentage will be that great, but it's I can't promise that because it depends on what the RFP says and the pension the performance of the pension plan.
But you know those are pretty significant numbers. I just think it's something we need.
Help me again. They recommended $1 million, and we put in 800 or 850,000.
Is what we planned for.
50,000 short there.
Yeah, what they'd said, Mayor, too, is they did recommend, ideally in a perfect world, it was whatever it was, a million something. In the end, what he said was, in his report, was recommend you put in a minimum of $200,000 more, which calculated out to
8.5% instead of 6.5.
One of the things with the pension plan that we have noticed in the past, at least up until about 2009, many times the actuary would come in, they're looking at pension plan results, they're looking at how many employees you have, they're looking at salary, mortality rates, all that stuff they look at to figure out what the liability and the contribution should be. We were always ahead of all of that until 2009. There were many years before 2009 when they would say,
you only need to contribute $200,000 or something like that. We still contributed 3.75%, and then 6.5% when we upped it to that. Stock market performance took a big hit, and we really, the plan hasn't recovered completely from that since then.
Snack to keep me going.
Any other questions?
Can we go back to the police? We haven't adjourned yet out of general.
We can.
We did.
We can go back when we get to the end and we reconvene as any unit city commission. We can go back and talk about police.
I think we should, since Chief, since you're here. I'm looking at your pro forma that you sent a minute ago, and I'd like to talk about that for just a minute.
Would you mind? Could we talk about it? I'd love to look at it, but I'd like some time to go through it before we talk about it again.
Well, we can do that. We can do that when I go back into the city commission.
Yeah, you can look at it and talk about it again, but I'd like to
talk about it tonight, if you don't mind. Okay, that's why I was just asking. We could do it a night when we've all had a little more time. That's fine.
Thank you.
Seven. We will now adjourn to convene as the Enid Economic Development Authority. All of the trustees of the Enid Economic Development Authority are present. The item 9, Enid Economic Development Authority special meeting is now in session. Item 10, discuss and take necessary action on the fiscal year 2016-2017 Enid Economic Development Authority financial plan. Take a deep breath, Aaron.
I believe this one's on page 183, if it's right. mainly just want to talk about the changes from FY16 to FY17, because there are a few changes. First of all, the HUD 108 loan payment. Previously, we had paid that out of CDBG, and at the end of the year, we did adjusting entries to book the revenue and expense in and out of the EEDA, and we had not budgeted for that. Just based on recommendations from the auditor and discussions, we want to go ahead and budget for that revenue and expense here so that we're not doing that as an adjustment. We can just book it that way from the beginning because EEDA is who owns the debt on this note. Also, there's potential transfer for the 66th Street TIF of $500,000 in this budget. And again, that will be a revenue and an expense going out to the Capital Improvement Fund, which is where the street improvement would be done from. We have increases in incentives for both the Academy Sports and Love's Travel Stop that were not in last year's budget. And then we have a decrease overall transfer from EMA, and that's due to reduced property purchases and appraisals and legal fees. The other expenses that were added to this budget are the 2015 taxable series note, which is related to the Academy incentive and the payments that go along with that. And then there's a $10,000 item added for the Northwest Oklahoma Water Plan, which is something that is related to ERDA. And I believe that Brent will come with what's going on with ERDA and that plan.
Thank you, Mayor, City Council members, City Manager, and staff. On behalf of ERDA and our staff and our board and 59 members, I want to thank you so much for this opportunity to share our story tonight, and also just for the continued support that you've given us over the last several years. As you know, in the community of Enid, there was a time when we weren't quite as aggressive in the area of economic development and tourism. And the last several years, we've really put our money where our mouth is and stepped up, and I believe we now have one of the best teams, if not the best team in the state, when it comes to being aggressive in economic development between our retail efforts, our lobbying efforts, our industry and local retail efforts, as well as our chamber efforts and Convention and Visitors Bureau. Just looking at the Main Street banquet last night, you see Enid continuing to be recognized as one of those top communities in the state that's being aggressive. I think that's one of the reasons why we, even though our revenues are down as a city, maybe not to the level that some of our other communities are. This is the bar chart that I use quite a little bit, especially whenever we're talking to retail folks and even some of our industrial folks about what's actually happening in the Enid economy. And gross retail sales is not the only indicator that you can look at of the health of a community, but I think it's a pretty good indicator, especially for Enid, because these numbers are not just Enid numbers. This is really Northwest Oklahoma. And the fact that even this year, as we make projections, you know, you're looking at maybe being back down to $800,000 in gross retail sales. Back in the day when we were at $650 million, that seemed like an astronomical number. So it is nice to see that those numbers have been up there, and I'm hopeful that it's a new normal here in the community of Enid. Just a little bit of my thoughts on projections going forward. We had peaked out in 2013, in the beginning of 2014, with oil and gas industry that was very strong in our community. In fact, in the Mississippi Lime oil play, we had 80 active rigs, which is a huge number of active rigs drilling in that area. Today, there are 9 active rigs in the Mississippi Lime oil play. Every rig has about 50 employees on it, and those rigs are supported by service industries that, in this case, were housed in Enid. We have lost some of those service companies. We've certainly lost those crews that were following the rigs around. I'm of the belief that even if the price of oil got back up to $60 a barrel, like some are saying by the end of this year, or $80 a barrel, like they're saying next year, I don't know that we're ever going to get back to 80 active rigs in the Mississippi Lime oil play. But what we will have is a much larger royalty payment that will be paid to our landowners in Northwest Oklahoma. That money ends up funneling to Enid, and I think that's going to be a huge boost to our gross retail sales again one of these days soon. The other thing that's keeping us afloat right now is construction projects. We still have over $2 billion worth of construction going on in this area. The biggest one is the Koch Nitrogen plant. They had estimated that by this summer they would have 1,100 construction workers out there at the site. They have exceeded that by several hundred already today, and they hope to peak in September or October of this year with even several hundred more than where they're at right now. That is continuing to go forward very well, and we'll start to reduce the number of construction workers sometime next spring, and construction will be almost over by October of 2017. But another thing to remember about this construction project is not just that they're adding 65 engineering jobs out there that are basically six-figure jobs, and that will be fantastic for our community, but they will also be doing turnovers every 6 months, which is where they take down part of the facility and repair it, clean it, and then turn it back on 30 days later. We've always had that out there at the plant, but it normally happened once a year, and it had a couple hundred people. With this expansion, they'll now start doing that every 6 months, and we'll have about twice as many people as what they had before. Somewhere between 500 and 600 people would be in town for those turnovers. That's good for hotel rooms. That's good for restaurants. That's good for Enid City sales tax numbers. The other thing that's under construction right now is Transportation Partners in Logistics. This is our new transload facility out on 66th Street. Continuing to work with them to maintain a presence in our community long term. But it is nice that they have chosen us, at least at this point, for offloading product. I put Love's Country Stores in here as something to share, because not everything that happens on a project is very public. Love's, everybody sees it whenever they drive by. But the thing I love most about the Love's project is that we were able to partner with Love's Country Stores to loop the water lines in that area, which allowed for us to have better fire support. It really just allowed us to have development in that area. And now you're seeing other things move in, such as the Hanover headquarters, the FedEx distribution center, and other things that are looking at that particular area of the city. Sometimes it doesn't always make the front page. And then of course, some of the retail development. This is what used to be Walmart, and it's nice to see retail still considering Enid a great place to go, and we're excited to be a part of that marketing effort. As far as your investment in Enid Regional Development Alliance, I like to look at the macro level. Since 2009, you've invested $4 million into the Enid Regional Development Alliance. This is, in general terms, how that money has been spent. About 25% of it's gone to retail incentives, a little more than that to industrial incentives, and then $1.8 million business recruitment, technical assistance, and marketing. And this is my favorite slide. This is what we have attempted to return back to you in your investment. We've taken your $4 million and we've leveraged that with what was last year a record number of businesses, with 59 member businesses. Whenever you first started investing in our organization, we had 23 members. Last year we hit 55 members and thought there's no way we could go any higher, and then ended up with 59 members this year. I'm gonna guess next year our number of members may be down a little bit because a couple of our local oil and gas companies have not invested, but we've had some new members step up too. So we'll see how that goes. And then of the state and federal funds, these are partnerships that we have done with local businesses as they have grown. These are actual applications that we've submitted, which a big one in there at about $26 million is Coke Plant and some of the partnerships with the state on that. But you can look at Advanced Pierre Foods and Jeffco and Parish Enterprises and several of those that we were involved in helping to put those applications together. Made a small list of some of the things that most folks are familiar with, of things we're proud of from this year. The Coke plant and the Hanover headquarters, those are huge. Everybody gets to see those, and Academy Sports as that moves forward. Coyote North is probably something not as many people are familiar with, but they're on Chestnut. They're a Canadian-owned company. Were their first U.S. domestic plant for production. You've got some housing opportunities in there, beef jerky, and Aircraft Structures International has doubled their employment in the last 12 months, gone from basically 20 to 40 employees, and they're one of those companies that very few people know about here in the community. A lot of what we do at the Development Alliance is trying to be proactive as well. We can be reactive whenever the phone rings, but we also need to be ready for the next thing. So we throw those under the term special projects. The first one is our Enid Summer Achievers Program. That's our internship program that we partner with Northern Oklahoma College to house students for the summer. Great opportunity for our businesses in town to access some of the best talent in the area. And we put Debbie Prescott in a car and we send her to every career fair and represent our local businesses to do that. And I won't go through all of those, but you can see some of those if you've got questions about them. These are things that we get involved with every single day. And then some of the big active projects that we're looking at for 2016, we're continuing to work with the state of Oklahoma on the Norse facility. The downtown hotel is, almost done. Clean Line Energy Project, which is the next big thing for Northwest Oklahoma, $2 billion transmission line from Guymon to Memphis, and then Transportation Partners and Logistics. This is our board. We have a great board at this point and are very passionate about growing our community. And that is my presentation. Would love to answer any questions that anybody might have.
Brent, when do you expect Love's to open up out there?
I'm not sure. I can't remember off the top of my head. Do you remember, Gerald?
Yeah, I don't have the exact date. Chris, I know they're working on some road work. I don't know if we have an exact date from them yet.
I don't particularly have an exact date, but I do know they ran into some problems with some utility relocations, optical line, telephone, and then they had some issues with construction. We can find out what their current projected date is if you'd like.
I think it'll be a month, 2 months.
I thought it was end of July at one point, but it might have changed.
We'll find out.
Yeah.
Let you guys know.
And I also know that they're kind of having an issue finding the components for the traffic light.
Really?
There's some long lead items.
Say that again, Chris.
Some of the long lead items for the traffic control signals.
Okay. We need to go, to Guthrie and knock over one of theirs, drag it back.
Of course not. I would never do that, sir.
Throw it out there.
Big log chain at work.
Coming for you, Guthrie.
Any other questions?
Yeah.
Keep up the good work.
Brent, I'd like to just make a comment since we're publicly
talking about ERDA. For those of you that haven't gone out and worked hand in hand with Brent and his team, it's really a pleasure to do so. Brent's, the ladies in his office, Lisa and Debbie, are perhaps two of the most qualified and dedicated employees I've ever seen. And Brent leads that with passion, so I've enjoyed working with you. I enjoy being on your board. You guys are doing great work. Debbie is as good as you're gonna ever find, and Lisa's as good as you're ever gonna find. And I just wanted to go on record saying that I'm really pleased with everything that you guys are doing.
I know they're watching right now on ET.
They're the two.
They can pay me tomorrow.
Thank you very much. I agree.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Item 11. We'll now adjourn to reconvene as the Mayor and Board of Commissioners. Aaron?
Yes. I'd like to just go back, Chief O'Rourke, if you don't mind, and Ben, I know that we haven't had a chance to look over this spreadsheet in total, but between now and the time that we have further discussions on this, looking at your pro forma, your EBITDA, you have about a five-year payback on a $750,000 investment, and you're looking at $180,000 net a year thereafter. I don't know how you can afford to not look at adding this into your budget right now.
Commissioner, I've had this for a little while. I'm the only one that's seen it. I just sent it out at y'all's request today. I sent it also to Gerald and to Aaron, so I've never really published it. So I've never given it as much thought as I probably should have, to be honest, because I didn't know whether this project was going to move forward at this time. So I'd like people that understand these things a little bit better than I do to take a look at it and see if it is a good deal.
Well, it looks good. If all these numbers are accurate, I would encourage you to really go back and flush out any assumptions that you think might be somewhat more risky. But I mean, at first glance, I would invest in this project pretty.
So is the implication that there would be no, they would be taking none of the profit until it's paid back in full?
Well, if these EBITDA numbers are right, I mean, the first year is 35,000 net, and third year is 180. You get another, so the total for the first 3 years is 350, and then you get another, if you just repeat year three, mm-hmm. four and five, then you're.
But are they agreeing to dedicate that entire amount towards debt service? Mm-hmm. I'm okay.
I mean, that's what I would do.
I mean, if that's how they're reading, I'm not sure if the implication is specifically that.
Well, their agreement is 5% of their revenues on the payback.
But so 5%, but their 5% of the revenue number here is a payback of a lot longer term of, I mean, of the 750,000. I don't think that pro forma suggests that the EBITDA is all going towards debt service
Those are things that we can flush out. But
well, there's some things that we had discussed in the early on too of a set lease payment per year along with percentage of
the royalty. Because if it's all we're getting is the royalty, then we're not ever going to get this thing paid for.
It seems like it would take a little bit, but that's something I want to visit with them about. And before we ever move forward on this anyway, we would have them come visit with you.
You may have let that $2 million figure scare you.
That's why it's not in the budget right now. Because that would just make it a $2,750,000
budget.
But it is a little bit more. It's 1.7. But, you know, it is an interesting project, that's for sure. And it would allow citizens of Enid basically to take classes, which is not really available.
So maybe I need to catch up on this because I don't have the history. This is not a project that you would actually own. They're asking you to construct the building and then you're participating in the.
We own it. They lease it.
And I guess I don't understand what this 5% revenue sharing is. Who are you sharing it with?
They're sharing it with us.
Who's they?
It's
an operator.
It's an LLC. That would actually, we would build it, they would lease it, and we have a lease agreement that's already basically done. And obviously, revenue now is an issue to see where we'd be in, say, 5 years, 10 years. And I forgot the name of their LLC. It's on the email. Person by the name of Dustin Merritt, and he's working through Sweet Law Firm in Oklahoma City.
That changes things pretty dramatically, but it still looks like it could make some money. So
it's very rarely will the police department come into a project that could actually raise revenue besides bad citations and things like that.
Is this mainly weekends deals, or is it all during the week, or how busy would it be?
It'd be all during the week.
So basically, we got to look at that, where people stay in motels every night of the week and eating every night of the week, too.
We'll tell you that they were fairly excited about that hotel going up around 13th and Garrett.
Sure, yeah, they are.
Yeah. And this would be a training facility for law enforcement and the public alike.
It's hard to put a number to that.
Most likely, as unique it is, possibly some military.
It's hard to put a number to those figures, but that's bringing people to Enid that stay here.
I love projects like this.
It's an interesting project. If you want to discuss it, you know, sometime.
Anything else, Aaron?
I'd be more than happy to tell you about the personnel that want to run it.
All right, thank you. I'm finished. Thank you.
Rodney.
I brought this up other day, or I think someone else brought it up, but I had also marked it down, but forgot a while ago, to discuss the credit card bill of $87,000. Did you guys work more on that, or what we could do with that?
We have not at this point, but we did take down a note that several of you wanted to consider looking at that. So our first step, and I didn't send anything off to Andrea, but we would want to look at the legality of that. If we get past that hurdle, then certainly I think what we would do, we have several different credit card systems. One of them is the deal where you can run your card right there at the window. One of them is the online utility system. And there's probably some other systems maybe that I'm leaving out. So we would need to start working on that. So our first step is to check into the legality of that. So I will certainly get with Andrea and note that, take a look at that, and see. And if that's promising, then we'll come back and pursue that if that's what you guys would like.
I try to recoup that back.
Was that 87,000 or 8,700?
It was 87,000.
87,000? Anyone else? Hearing none. Item 12.
Motion. So moved.
Motion by Aaron. Second by Ben. Please cast your vote.
I want to stick around some.
Motion carries 6-1.
Trade some time for 50. Somebody said, "Oh, we got it."
Thank you for joining us for the Enid City Commission meeting. If you have any questions or comments, visit our website at enid.org.